actually so potent that clearly the idea contributed massively to dismantling the NPP out of power. Imagine encouraging a situation where you can have what, 10 people, 7, I mean, 20 people, 100 people in the NDC having great ideas of that nature. And as General Secretary, I'll be looking out for people with real solutions, with real answers, in order for us to be able to take this party to the next level. So generally, that's what it is. So
talking about building the party, you know, the NDC has been very popular with the Zongo community, etc. But it appears the MPP has begun eating into that constituency. They have a Nasara coordinator, and even in the northern region, if you see the pattern of voting, etc., it appears that the MPP is gradually splitting that base with the NDC. I know that has come to your notice. Is that a concern, and how do you hope to resolve that?
Definitely, you must appreciate that that's the job of your opponent. Your opponent must do whatever it is to be able to eat into your territory, and you also must target the territory of your opponent. Now, so it's just like football. You try to defend your goal so that you don't concede. At the same time, you try to breach the goal of your opponent. So it's for me, I look at it as a beautiful competition. They are making inroads into some of our strongholds, traditional strongholds. We need to find ways in which we can defend those traditional strongholds better. At the same time, we need to find ways in which we can enter into their stronghold as well. So, and I believe we can. I believe this is a party that has got the capacity to get it done. And that's the emphasis for me, to make sure. If you can be sure about one thing, some of us want to virtually devote 24/7 to thinking through means by which we can be far more effective. Finding answers, finding solutions, looking at how things have been done, and believing that there are better ways in which we can do it far better, much more scientific, and also far more data driven. And that's definitely for some of us the understanding. You want to have pure data that helps you to know exactly the best way to get it done. I don't believe that the same way we've done things, let's say 30 years ago in 1982, or 20 years ago, in the year 2002, that should be the same way we should be doing things today. No, there's a younger generation that is far more interested in different things being done, and the party must literally open up itself to that new challenge that can appeal to a much younger generation. And I think that's something we can do. We have not traditionally done very well on campuses, and I don't know why we shouldn't do well on campuses, because when it comes to ideas, the battle of ideas, I think we are superior to the MPP, and I'm not making any wild claims at all. I think if you watch clearly, even the manifesto, many ways in which we can reach out to, especially that younger generation, and let them know that if you're looking at the two vehicles for power, this vehicle is the superior vehicle in terms of opening up, enabling you to have, shall I call it, your views far more represented in terms of the way we go. I believe also in terms of character, this party possesses far greater character, far greater credibility. And leadership fundamentally is about character, it's about credibility. So we have ways in which, both on the basis of character and also on the basis of competence, we have the better vehicle, and that should be able to make a massive appeal to especially the young generation and to the country as a whole.
What are people think that you're a more competent party with people with greater character and competence is an issue for another day, really. The MPP won the election on the basis of the fact that your candidate, President Mahama at the time, was incompetent. The same was repeated in 2020, and he lost. 2016, he lost quite massively. So I think you have quite a torrid job trying to reverse that, telling the people that indeed we are the competent people, rather. The other guys who said we are incompetent are the really incompetent people. That should be a tall order for you.
It's always a combination of things, you know. When you've been in office for about 8 years, it's always an issue where your opponent can create the impression that we are the better alternative. You must naturally go through a cycle where familiarity brings a certain contempt. So after 8 years, it's like we are familiar with you. So sometimes even the least problem gets, as it were, blown beyond the, shall I call it, the level it ought to be. So for example, we were very wrongly accused, for example, for bringing Dumso into Ghana. Mm-hmm. And that was a massive part of the problem that led to our loss of power in 2016. But that Dumso actually was not our
It's because you couldn't solve it.
No, but hold on. We actually solved it.
No, I mean, that's still debate.
No, there's no debate.
Dr. Donko said that he solved it.
It's not even about Dr. Donko. I'm talking about NDC. NDC solving. There should be, you see, when I hear things about there is a debate, to be honest with you, that tells me that you, as journalists, are doing a very lousy job. You guys are doing a lousy job. Because really, you should be able to set the record straight on this issue. The fact checking by you journalists should be able to let MPP run away from even daring to actually claim that Dunso was not solved before the year 2016. The fact that it's still being left to question in the minds of some people clearly shows that you, the media, should do a much, much better job than you've done. Because in a proper dispensation, when the facts are being straightened, where the records can be checked, you, the media, should be able to let everyone in this country know. It should not be left for a debate at all. So there's no debate about it. So we resolve it. And we resolve a problem that no previous government had been able to resolve.
But will you agree that it took you a longer time to resolve this?
Yeah, because it's normal. It's normal. If you have a combination of factors that led to the doomsaw, it's not something you can resolve overnight. Don't forget, doomsaw happened during the time of Kufuor. Doomsaw had happened during the time of Rawlings. Doomsaw actually started in the latter part of Prof. Mills. So you can tell it's a historical problem that happens. In our case, got compounded because why? There was what you call force majeure that happened, for example, to the line that brings the pipeline that brings, for example, gas from Nigeria. Was it that Kosovo dam basically reached a level that we hadn't even seen before? You had issue that had to do with affecting even the turret bearing of the FPS. So many problems that actually will happen, and those are not things you can solve overnight, but we resolved them. You understand? So I'm saying that in 8 years, you have that situation where people get tired. When people start feeling as if, no, you haven't really done enough. So your opponent can capitalize and create impression of being great. But the truth, if you watch exactly what they've done over the last 6 years, the resources that have been available to them, this is the most disastrous government in our history. Yeah. And so when you're talking about incompetence, they actually are a walking embodiment of total incompetence. I don't think there's any government in our fourth Republican history that's been as incompetent as the one that we have in place today. So.
This is a point of view. My guest is Fifi Fiavi Kwetey, newly elected General Secretary of the National Democratic Congress. We're having a conversation about the party, himself, and the future of the party, and himself as General Secretary. We'll take a short break. We'll return and continue with more. Don't go away.
Welcome to Jamila Home, a signature business that houses the most luxurious antique and contemporary furniture. We stock presidential, royal, ministerial, and executive furniture with complimentary decor. We have a wide selection of beautifully maintained pieces, such as the amazing Windsor chairs with one of the largest choices of genuine Regency and Victorian dining furniture, which once stood for England's finest craftsmanship. Renowned across the world for its luxurious and detailed features, alongside a brilliant blend of Italian contemporary Versace royal set in absolute elegance. Visit our website, www.jamilahome.com. Contact us via phone call and WhatsApp on 0302-437-228 and 0205-555-525. We are located at 13 Westland Boulevard, Accra. Jamila Home, your first and best furniture showroom in Ghana and the world.
Did you know that every time you drink Richoco, you support 100% sustainably sourced Ghanaian cocoa and give a child access to quality education? Well done. This advert is FDA approved.
Bank of Ghana has upgraded the One Ghana Citi coin with enhanced security features. The coin will be put into circulation from 12th December 2022. It is similar to the existing One Ghana Citi coin in shape, form and images. The coat of arms in front and the scale of justice at the back. The upgraded One Ghana Citi coin is bimetallic with outer gold and inner silver. The coin has a pronounced rough edge and incorporates a latent image which appears in a rectangular form below the scale of justice at the back. The latent image changes from a radiating star to a One Ghana Citi symbol sandwiched between two stars when tilted. The assistant and their graded one Ghana Cedi coins will co-circulate until the assistant coin is gradually withdrawn. The general public is encouraged to accept the coins and use them.
Welcome back to The Point of View. My guest is Fifi Fiavi Kwetey, General Secretary, newly elected General Secretary of the National Democratic Congress. Over the weekend, the party went to Congress and elected national executives for the next 4 years. Indeed, these are the executives that will lead the party into election 2024, led by Chairman Asirun Ketia, Fifi Kwetey himself as the Chief Administrator of the party, Organizer Joseph Yamin, Youth Organizer Opare Ado, women's organizer, Hannah Bisu, and a few other people. Many have said that this is a very strong team. Indeed, Gabi has said that they are a team of propagandists. He's responded to that already. But, Fifi, you know, in the race, you know, we saw three of you. We saw yourself, we saw Elvis, and we saw Otokuno, three very formidable candidates. And people even said that the three of you should not have even run against yourself because the team will need the qualities of each of the three of you to work. I know you'll find a way of, you know, bringing all together. Mm-hmm. But we thought, or a lot of people thought, that given the fact that you and Elvis belong to the same generation, mm-hmm. you're going to split the votes up there, mm-hmm. and then the younger generation, who may be more, mm-hmm. were going to be taken by Otokuno. Mm-hmm. And given the fact that we heard that Otokuno was being supported by General and a few other people, mm-hmm. we thought that the people who loved General and mm-hmm. wanted him to win, mm-hmm. also going to focus on Otokuno, mm-hmm. whilst the two of you split the votes up there, making it easier for Otokuno to win. I don't know whether you came across any of these analysis, and I don't know what your thoughts on those matters were, you know, in the course of the race.
I think those are armchair analysis mm-hmm. being done by people who clearly were completely cut off from the reality on the mm-hmm. ground. Because on the ground there was no such thing at all. Mm-hmm. All the delegates were looking at the three people based on whether they are capable of delivering mm-hmm. victory for the party. That's number one consideration of the delegates. I mean, the issue about you belong to different generation. I mean, where from that? Mm-hmm. There's nothing about generational business. It's about winning power. Mm-hmm. You want to win power.
No, but the generational matter is important because if people in a particular generation can identify with a certain candidate.
No, but they want to win power. Mm-hmm. The young generation want to win power.
And if they can identify with somebody,
the fact that you are younger doesn't mean you can deliver power. Mm. Because if that's it, then only young people will be able to win in election mm. in Africa. Because don't forget, Africa is a very young continent. Mm. But so it doesn't work that way. I think it's a poor analysis, if you ask me. People are looking for candidates who are able to deliver power. Mm. The age business comes second. Mm. You are interested in, are you capable of delivering that? And if you can deliver that, why not? Whether you are 80 or 70 or 60 or 50 or 40, doesn't matter. As long as you can be seen as somebody who can deliver power, of course they will go for you. And I think really that's what I really want. The issue about whether you are supported by General or not General, I think also another very moot point. Mm. Because don't forget, General himself had a battle on his hand to fight. And he's not going to be carrying anybody. Mm. And I was not expecting General to carry me to power, no. I should be able to stand on my own 2 feet and win power. I don't want to go to delegate and tell them vote for me because General is supporting me. No. I have my own pedigree. I have my own experience. I have my own reason why I'm running. Now, so if there's anybody who was actually hoping that General should carry him to power, then the person was completely deluded. Mm-hmm. In fact, General once tried carrying Yao Jian into power, and Yao Jian failed miserably as an organizer in 2016. So this, 2014 or so, so this number carrying, no matter how popular you are. Listen, even Jerry Ronis, mm-hmm. a great fan of this party, supported candidates who lost. Mm-hmm. The great fan of the party, supported candidates who lost. Atamios supported candidates who lost. John Mama support Kamala, not openly, but if he had liking to some candidate, not all of them will win. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing about any individual carrying anybody to anywhere. You have to cross that river by yourself, mm-hmm. by your own merit, by your own pedigree. And I think that's what the delegate focus upon. So the issue about splitting vote and somebody going through, I don't think that ever came into my mind at all.
I recall sometime within the last 2 years at a funeral at Sakumono. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had a quick chat and I asked whether you, I heard you were going, mm-hmm. you were planning to run for General Secretary. Mm-hmm. You say yes. if general would not run, then you would run. Sure. Why was it so important that you would only run if general said he was not going to run?
Because for me, I look at these things not as a personal thing at all. I've always been somebody who is quite, I look at the collective. Mm. Yeah, for me, running for position is not like something I want for myself, no. In fact, most people do not know. But 2005, I actually was not going to put up myself to become the propaganda secretary of the NDC. I was not. I actually was convinced, to run for that position because of Rollins. Mm. Yeah, because of Rollins. He kept saying, no, you need to run. I said, no, I don't need to, sir. I can help the party. Because already I was helping the party. I was going into various programs, speaking for the party. I was hosting Crossfire. Mm-hmm. I was the one who spoke for the party on what you call so many of the media. At that time, I don't think Citi was before 2005. When did Citi start?
2005.
Exactly. So I would say ahead of 2005, Citi wasn't there. So Joy FM, News File, and so on. I used to be the one who mostly represented the party. I said I could continue doing that with somebody else occupying the position of the communication chief of the NDC. But it was Ronnie who kept saying, no, you need to run for the position. That's why eventually I did. In fact, what people do not know, in 2005, when I ran for the position of propaganda secretary, I never campaigned anywhere. That tells you the extent to which, for me, it was not something that was something I really wanted that badly. I never campaigned. I never went to any constituency, never went to any region. I didn't campaign until the Congress Day. Congress Day, actually, I appeared on Congress Day with just a few people holding a few flyers of mine. Effectively, I was telling the candidate, I was telling the delegate, you know what, if you vote for me, I will do a fantastic job. But if you feel somebody else can do the job, no problem at all. I can be in the background and help. And that really has been my attitude. Now, why didn't I want to run against the general secretary? If you wanted to, because it's simple. If I feel you are doing your job, a good job, I don't have a problem being behind and helping. For me, I felt he had done a fantastic job as a general secretary. And if he was minded to continue, why not? I would have stayed behind in order to see how well we can help. But once it is that he indicated that he did not want to go again, I believe the soul of this party requires a certain pedigree. And I felt that by the very combination of the background I have, actually can step in there and be able to actually hold it to the level. And actually, I believe I can take it to the next level. I genuinely believe I can take it to the level. Because in terms of background, the combination of experiences, I would say he walked into that position with less experience than I'm working into that position. At the time he was working to a general secretary position, he had been a stockbroker, which of course I've been. People don't know he has been a stockbroker.
Okay, he worked
at NTSC. Okay. Not just rural bank. He worked actually at an NTSC, National Trust Holding Company.
I see.
Yeah, and actually, so he was a stockbroker, and I was a stockbroker myself.
But you worked there too, right?
No, I work at Strategic Affairs Securities.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So I was a stockbroker too. I mean, he was an MP. I had the same background as an MP. He was deputy minister for Agric. I was deputy minister, and then also became minister. You understand? So by the combination, and also I happen to have had a prior experience of working at the national office. Mm-hmm. He didn't have that working into a general secretary position. So I feel by the very combination of factors, my experiences, fit me very, very, very well towards moving into this position and taking it to the next level.
I see. You talk about the fact that, you've not done well on campuses. In fact, others have extended that to say that you've not done well with intellectual groups, professional groups, etc. I don't know what your plan is for those groups, especially as it was over the weekend that we saw the professional forum, Pro Forum, being now officially affiliated to the NDC, a party which is almost 30 years old, now recognizing, the affiliation of a professional group that was, something people thought should have happened earlier. And that underscores maybe the fact why you've not done very well among professional groups and even campuses.
I won't look at it that way. I think that would be simplifying it. Because really, when you're talking about professionals, who are professionals? I voted for NDC when I was a stockbroker. I was a top professional. And I know many, many, many bankers.
With professional groups?
No, hold on. But a professional group is made up of professionals. So it's not a group that is doing the voting. Mm. It's the individuals who belong to that group. I know many people
who are... But groups often speak with one voice.
No, but see, what people don't understand is that the individuals who belong to those groups don't go in a ballot but thinking about what their association has said. They are individuals who actually know which party they want to vote for. So the fact that a group is loud doesn't necessarily mean that every individual are going to do exactly that. People, you must appreciate, even in churches. I've been in churches before where the pastor is very vehemently against a particular political party. The majority of the people want to go into the ballot, but they go and vote against that party, for the party that the pastor is. So people are not robots, okay? They have a conscience of their own. So the thing about only professional group, what I can tell you is this, that the very history of the NDC, okay, pitted us against a particular segment of the society. Mm-hmm. Because we are coming from a military, revolutionary background. And by the very nature of that revolution, I mean, we tended to antagonize people. For example, the media. Mm-hmm. The media clearly became what you call an addition to the opposition. Mm-hmm. And that's remained the case for so long, where most people who are very loud in the media tended to feel comfortable when they are against the NDC rather than when they are for the NDC. Why? Because right from the very beginning, NDC was seen as a group that actually persecuted the media, had a culture of silence. I mean, sent journalists to jail and so on. So that naturally was the case. The same applies to Ghana Bar Association, and we today it continues to have, the interesting case of being very alive when the NDC is in office. And as soon as NDC leaves office, they go into a certain hibernation. I've not seen anything, I've not heard anything. Whatever is happening is perfect, it's fine. So that also is another issue. So we had that scenario. But I'm thinking that the reason why I'm talking about campuses has to do with the fact that I feel we've got such superior policies, and also I've got such a richness of character and credibility that we should be able to make a pitch that will make people feel far more confident to associate in the NDC. My worry is that historically, even people who have worked into workplaces where there were a lot of NDC people, somehow they were not feeling confident enough to show that they were NDC. And I never understood that. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things I do when I walk into, for example, every place I've worked, the very first week, I let everybody know that I'm a strong NDC person. Mm-hmm. In the first place, signaling to MPP that if you used to control this turf and as it were, taking down the NDC, this man who is working here, that's not happening anymore. Mm-hmm. But it's not everybody who does that. I feel that NDC sympathizers need to show that much more, capacity to take
on. You think the MPP members do that
more?
Yeah,
they are naturally more loud. Yeah, it's always been the case. For example, on campus, from campus in 1992, I was NDC chairman of NDC in 1992. Mm. Basically, MPP sought to intimidate NDC people because they are naturally louder. Mm. And the NDC guys who often support NDC don't want to be engaging in that, and that also is an issue. So when you allow people to intimidate you by making too much noise, a point may come where you may even be wondering whether are you there at all, mm-hmm. or it's just them. That's one area some of us will continue to work on to see mm-hmm. a complete reversal mm-hmm. of that. I mean,
but that would mean changing the personality of people, because there are people who are naturally reticent or quieter compared to people you describe as
really
loud.
You can be assertive. Yeah. You can be more assertive. Mm. I mean, this party was founded by a man who believed in positive defiance. Mm. A man who believed that, listen, you don't allow anybody to put you down. You don't allow anybody to trample on you. You have to be strong enough to assert who you are. Mm. And I want to see a party that's much more assertive. A party that has got far more fire in their belly to be able to fight for what is true. Mm. Not just doing it quietly, but also doing it with confidence. I want to see members who belong to Ghana Bar Association, I mean, to be able to say, I mean, come out with much more confidence. I want to see people who are sympathetic to the NDC in the media being bold enough to assert the fact that they have leanings toward the NDC. It's not a problem. You can still do your objective job without feeling ashamed that you have a leaning for the NDC. Mm-hmm. I feel that it's too much, too often. You see journalists who are capable of showing their leaning for MPP, but when a few are able to show, and somebody are shy, they don't want to show. I completely understand that. Mm-hmm. In fact, I can tell you, one of the main reasons why some of us even were known as people who were pushing for the media. You remember I used to manage the Lens newspaper at the time, also features editor for the Palaver. Mm-hmm. The main reason why I did that was simply because I didn't understand why journalists were being so shy to show that they belong to the NDC. I never understood it. I mean, this is a party that's a great party. Why are you letting anybody intimidate you? And who are those who are intimidating you anyway? Mm-hmm. Do they know much better than you? They don't. Mm-hmm. Are they more superior than you in terms of capacity? They are not. Do they have much more character than you have? They know. Are they more credible than you? They know. So I don't understand why the millions of our supporters should allow any group in this country should be making them feel as if they are second class citizens. That for me it should not be. And that's something I intend to work to make sure we change that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Fifi Kwetey is my guest. We're delving into some really serious matters. But we'll take another break, we'll return and see what the NDC has to offer as an alternative to the new Patriotic Party. This is The Point of View. Don't go away.
Did you know that every time you drink Richoco, you help empower local women in Ghana? Well done. This advert is FDA approved.
Finally, anyone can become a house owner.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. You will flip a real estate gaming platform that allows you to play and stand a chance of winning a house or cash or consolidation, such as savings towards a house. Simple and easy to play. Visit www.yugoflip.com. Buy a ticket to enter the game. Wait for the end of the game to enjoy the win. Anyone can win. Flip it or own it. This advertisement has been vetted and approved by the Gaming Commission of Ghana. Play responsibly, not for persons below 18 years, and gaming can be addictive.
You're welcome back to The Point of View. My guest is Fifi Kwetey. We are looking at the events of the last few weeks, and particularly last weekend, where the National Democratic Congress elected National Executive. Fifi Kwetey was elected as General Secretary of the party, beating off competition from two other formidable candidates, Peter Buamo Tokuno and Elvis Efrie Ankra. We've dealt into quite a number of things. But now people think that the NDC is not doing enough to show that it has the ideas in terms of providing alternative solutions to the problems of the country. So, for example, when the NPP was in opposition, mm-hmm. any time the budget was read, they mm-hmm. had their own version of the budget. Mm-hmm. The state of the nation address, yeah. they came up with what they call the real or the true state of the nation. Mm-hmm. You know, we saw that over the period, mm-hmm. but we've not, you know, seen any of these with the NDC. What is the matter? What's the problem? Of course, you are not entering into mm-hmm. the national leadership mm-hmm. as a general secretary.
Okay.
But will you know what might have been happening and what we are to expect now that you are in moving forward?
You know, let me try to clarify a bit of that. So, for example, NDC in 2016, okay, by the end of 2016, handed over to the NPP states of the economy, mm-hmm. and let me give you some of the highlights of the states of the economy at the time we handed over to them. We handed over to the MPP an economy that was so strong mm-hmm. that no matter who was in charge in 2017, we were growing by 8%. Mm-hmm. That is an alternative, because that is what it is we handed over to you. Mm-hmm. So if you have a period of 6 years and you're asking for alternative is exactly what we handed over to you. Mm-hmm. You must try to match up to that. If we are capable of delivering an economy that without your work was going to deliver 8% to you, you are in power mismanaging things and asking for alternative. The alternative is exactly what it is you took us from and taking us down. Mm-hmm. We've done that. If we were able to do that with the resources that were so scarce, that tells you if we have been given the massive resources that you have over the last 6 years, we would have actually done far more. We're handing over to you cocoa production that was about 1 million metric tons. Mm-hmm. You are not taking it all the way down. You're asking for alternative. Alternative, see exactly what we're handing over to you. And if we had the resources available to you, how much more we would have done? We're handing over to a country that effectively had been able to even grow at the same level without what you call oil production, with all the, you know, it's called the non-oil growth in 2016 was about 4%. Mm. It was about the same that MPP had when they came to power the first year, which tells you that even with all the doomsday that we are resolved, with all the things that were going on well, their non-oil growth and our non-oil growth in 2016 was the same. And you're talking about alternative. We are showing that we have been able to do that for you, I mean, for this country. So when I think generally, they are bungling it. They are totally losing it. And the only thing they can say is that provide the alternative. Provide the alternative. You take a reference to exactly the state of the economy handed over to you, and that should tell you about what a superior group had done with less resources. And stop asking about alternatives. Because if you want alternative, just see exactly the quality of the job that had been done. It was not perfect, but it was a far better job. Now, so all you need to do is to say, even with less resources, these are the kind of string of successes that was delivered. And you are even taking us down.
But the challenges of the state, you know, change over time. So, for example, now we are in a situation where we say we are highly debt distressed. You know, so some
and who created that?
Some solutions.
No, who created that?
We were told
it's cumulative. What do you mean cumulative? Cumulative means
for example, debt from Eurobond in the past, you know, are part of the problems we have. Of course, it's a fact that this government is borrowed quite a lot, gone to the international capital.
We had borrowed 120 billion cedis by the end of 2016. Hold on. By the end of 2016, the total debt stock of the country was 120. Okay? So what do you mean cumulative? Cumulative means what? You have come within a period of 6 years. You have taken our debt to, now I can't even imagine where it is. I've lost count. You're talking about cumulative? It's just recklessness. So don't tell me about cumulative. It's recklessness, that's what we have. So don't give me that excuse about cumulative. So the problems of the country have done what? It's the same difficulties that different governments have faced. Have they faced doom so? Have they faced doom so that we face?
Hold on.
What COVID? COVID? Has COVID, Togo not faced COVID? And yet still having a much better and stronger economy? Has Cote d'Ivoire not faced COVID? Has Rwanda not faced COVID? So what is this excuse about COVID? Have they, for example, faced the single spine salary that we had to face, which took the wage envelope from 2.5 billion annually upward to 7.5 within a matter of a year? It took it all the way up to 10. Have they faced that? If not.
You've also seen the financial...
Self-inflicted. Completely self-inflicted. When we came to office, we faced difficulty in the financial sector as well. Ghana Commercial Bank and TOR were on their knees. We now had to do a rescue job of that thing because that thing could have actually spread what you call contagion across the whole financial sector. We resolved that with minimum noise. So don't give me that thing about financials. What financial sector? It's self-inflicted. And a lot of it, they took advantage and pocketed a lot of that money themselves and using excuses. What financial sector? It's just plain excuses by a bunch of incompetent people who are corrupt to the core. That's what you got, toxic means of corruption and incompetence. That's what we have. So don't give me that about financial sector. What financial sector?
I see. Quite a number of people have been sending messages. Prince Henry Kufuoredua says, congratulations to Honorable Fifi Avle Kwetey. May God grant him more strength and wisdom for the tasks ahead come 2024. With Chairman General Mosquito and General Secretary. Fifi Avle Kwetey and the rest of the team, Victory 2024 is ours. Victory 2024 is and must be a communal labor for all. So rest in peace, Comrade AU Farouk in Tamale. Good evening, Salam. Please say hello to my boss, Honorable Fifi Kwetey, for me. This is from Hassan from Tamale. We are very proud of him, very proud to have him lead us into restoring the real moral fiber of our dear nation, Ghana. Good evening to you all, especially Fifi Kwetey. Congratulations to you, sir. Adams Fraser, number 9, number 10, NDC Vibrant Group in Tamale. You appear to be having a lot of fans in Tamale.
Yeah, Tamale is like my second home.
I'm watching you live from the Captain Latte. I'm Nicholas Akoto Jamwa, a branch chairman of GHS2 branch. I pray the good Lord will protect you, my General Secretary, Honorable Fifi Kwetey. Victory 2024 is coming. This one says, good evening, Salam. Indeed, the NDC delegates have elected a champion man qualified enough to be CEO of our great party, the NDC. This is a clear manifestation of the adage, from the pool of gold, one does not fetch rusted metal. Now the world will testify who have the real men. Rescue mission activities. This Ernest Unique Akisko tying. Ganiu Fatal from Adina says, good evening. Congratulations to all elected executive chairman, general, and those who couldn't make it. We appreciate your love for the NDC. Please ask Honorable Fifi how he's going to make sure that the good ideas and policies of Honorable Tokuno is going to be manifested, because there are good ideas and policies in his manifesto. Thank you. Yeah, that's an interesting one. How are you going to ensure that you harness the ideas, the strengths of the persons who contested you in the race, and indeed, by extension, all the other contenders in the races across? How are you going to ensure that you leverage on, you know, some of the ideas they had, their strength, etc., to build a formidable team?
You know, I've always believed that, in fact, the one of the reasons why I was that successful when I was in charge of the communication of the party was because I had a very open door policy. As long as something is pure quality, I have no problem where it's coming from. What is good for me, what is good, must actually be encouraged. So for me, once an idea is a good idea, I definitely am open up to make sure that we use it to make the party better. And basically even give credit to the person from whom those ideas are coming. So I'm naturally going to be very open, not just to the ideas that's coming from Peter Tokono, but from every other person. Mm. Great ideas from Ofosuanpofo, who didn't win to become the chairman. Ideas from people who try to become national organizers. Ideas from, so for me, it's about looking for all the best and brightest ideas and see how it is we can pull them into what I call a 360-degree pool that will be able to be used for our party. So it's no problem.
But one other observation that was made at the Congress was how key officials who were speaking at that Congress appeared to be endorsing even John Mahama ahead of his time. So, for example, the regional chairman of the NDC, Greater Accra, in his welcome address, I mean, when he appeared, was wearing a GM Tuasso cap. And a whole lot of things. People were saying, okay, in addressing John Mahama, the president in waiting, etc. People have said, of course, Dufour has declared his intention. The former mayor of Kumasi, is it? Kujubunso, and all those guys are there. They have declared their intention, they want to run. Is it not unfair that key officials of the party will be appearing to be endorsing one subtly against all of them? That could be a difficulty.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Anyway, but the point is this. The history of our country has shown that there's always a massive advantage that goes with those who have had what you call a much more longer run. I mean, at the top position. That was the case for Rawlings in 1992. I mean, from 1982 to 92, he had that clear advantage. And of course, Kufuor had the advantage as well and was able to go ahead of the others. Prof. Mills had the advantage as well and went ahead of everybody. And so does Nana Akufo-Addo. And of course, GM as well from, if you like it, from 2009, I mean, as vice president, then became president 2013 to 16, and then now opposition leader. For the last election, clearly he does have an advantage going into whatever contest it is. But it doesn't mean necessarily that it's going to be a done deal just because he has got. But the history shows that he clearly has a massive advantage. So I suspect a lot of people feel already that, given the history of our country, it's definitely going to be the same situation. But it's going to be an open. I don't think John Mahama himself believe that it should be a foregone conclusion. I mean, as a competitor, I'm sure he's quite prepared to be able to run a race, to be able to convince the delegate that he's still the best choice for the party. And of course, we encourage those who think that they have better ideas, we should also be able to do so. I mean, for me in politics, the only thing that I see all the time is this. It's a complete tragedy for a serious politician to, as it were, invest money, invest resources, invest time, invest psychological energy and go and get a 2% or get a 3%. For me, that tells you that you are a complete disaster. If you can be that clueless, if you can be that disillusioned, as not to know that you actually have no weight at all, you have no weight at all, it tells you that you are in fact, I think that we should actually have a system where people like that actually are penalized. Because you have just wasted the time of everybody.
Wasted
everybody's time is other. So people like that actually must be penalized for wasting everybody's time.
You know? That's interesting. That would be suppressing democracy.
No, not suppressing. It's about letting people not waste people's time and waste people's energy.
I see, Fifi. Yeah. What will be your final word? We run out of time.
My final word is that I look forward to working and giving everything I've got. I mean, in the service of this party, just as I've done from 1992. I look forward to this opportunity as one that gives me a clear platform to be able to work with other elected executives in order to position this party to rescue this country again. This country requires a serious, salvation that must happen, because from what we've seen in the MPP, if it continues at this rate, trust me, our future is in complete calamity. It's in complete doom, and we need to work hard to take power and also to be able to use that power to empower our people. And I believe that we will do just that.
Thank you very much. My guest tonight has been Fifi Kwetey. My name is Selomadun. Thanks so much for your company. See you some other time.